या नबी सलाम अलैका, या रसूल सलाम अलैका, या हबीब सलाम अलैका, सलावातुल्लाह अलैका या नबी।
नहमदुहु व नुसल्ली अला रसूलिहिल करीम أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم
We praise him subhanahu wa ta'ala and send durood upon his noble messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Thereafter I seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the outcast Shaitan.
Dear audience, in the previous program, we talked about the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam's ride having reached Medina, and Hazrat Abu Ayyub Ansari radiallahu ta'ala anhu had the honor of hosting the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Now, the first thing that the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam did was to build the Masjid Nabawi, the Prophet's mosque sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. The land belonged to two orphans, Sahal and Suhail of Bani Najjar, who were related through the maternal grandmother of the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. It was an open field where people often dried dates. The Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam chose this piece of land for the mosque and inquired, "Whose place is this?" And the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam was informed that this place belongs to Sahal and Suhail. They both came. They said, "O Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, we offer this place without any price." But the Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, who was a guardian for the orphans and a refuge for the poor, he sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam did not approve of acquiring the land without the orphans being compensated for it. Therefore, Hazrat Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu bought that land for the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam's mosque for 10 dinars. Now, the construction work of the Prophet's mosque began with mud bricks. The pillars of the mosque were made of palm trunks, and the roof was made of palm bark. Thus, the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam's mosque was built. The Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam was personally involved in the construction, to the extent that dust would fall on the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam during constructions. The companions would say, "O Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, permit us to serve." Then the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam replied, "You should do your work and allow me to do mine." This was the mercy of both worlds sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. When Hazrat Khadija passed away in Makkah, the children were still young. There was an issue of raising and nurturing them. The Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam contracted the nikah with Sauda radiallahu ta'ala anha. He sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam also married Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. She had not yet departed from her parents' residence. So when the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam came to Medina, the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam's chambers were built along with the Masjid Nabawi. Later, the number of these chambers continued to increase and was especially set aside for the wives of the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. The conditions of these chambers is also noteworthy and worth reflecting upon. What is the comparison of the pure family of the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, and where are those small chambers made of mud bricks? Hazrat Hassan Basri radiallahu ta'ala an, says that in the time of Umar ibn al-Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him, when I was entering my youth, I was able to reach and touch the roof of these chambers. That is, that the houses that were adjacent to the Masjid al-Nabawi were so minimal in height, and they were made of mud bricks and palms. This was the simplicity of the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam's house, and this was the simplicity of the Masjid al-Nabawi sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, which was to become the center of focus and attention and the center of guidance. This was the mosque where the great decisions of the Ummah were to take place. As mentioned, a very simple mosque with a roof made of palm bark and pillars made of palm trunks. Its four walls were made of mud bricks. Now, a great challenge before the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam was that of the two great tribes, Aws and Khazraj, who had been continuously at war for many years. But our religion came to eliminate enmities, distances, and distinctions. The Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam guided them and established brotherhood between them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةٌ فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَ أَخَوَيْكُمْ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ.
The believers are brothers, and when there is a dispute between them, make peace between them. The Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam established brotherhood in such a way that two companions became brothers. He sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam made a muhajir, a migrant from Makkah, and an ansari, a helper of Medina, brothers. Thus the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam broke the idols of hatred, the idols of sectarianism, idols of discrimination and distinction. Hazrat Zaid bin Haritha radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who was the freed slave of the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, was made Hazrat Hamza's brother. In Arabia, it was considered extremely inappropriate. How does a slave compare to a master? Hazrat Zaid was made the brother of Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam chose Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala an as his brother sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam selected Hazrat Abdul Rahman bin Auf radiallahu ta'ala an to be the brother of Hazrat Saad bin Rabi'a. And what an ideal brotherhood. They were always ready and willing to sacrifice everything for each other. The muhajireen, the immigrants, had to abandon their homes. They were forced to immigrate so silently that many of them could not even bring their belongings with them. The brotherhood that the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam established was so that hatred was eliminated and discrimination was eliminated, and the muhajireen were also supported and comforted. Hazrat Saad took Hazrat Abdul Rahman bin Auf to his house and said, "Brother, this is my house. Take half of it, and half of it is mine. This is my agriculture. Take half of it. Leave half for me. These are my two wives. If you want, I can divorce one of them. After Idda, you can marry her and unsettle down." Hazrat Abdul Rahman bin Auf radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, "Thank you for your love. Show me the way to the market." Then he went to the marketplace and began selling oil and cheese. Hazrat Abdul Rahman ibn Auf, who was one of the 10 companions promised paradise, one of the Ashra Mubashara, was so blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he became incredibly wealthy. Hadrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha relates that once there was a commotion in Medina. Caravans came. 500 camels came to Medina, full of trade goods. It came to be known that all of these belonged to Hazrat Abdurrahman bin Auf radiallahu ta'ala, which he had compassionately offered in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This was the brotherhood and mutual love between the companions. The point is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them success out of love for each other. The Aus and Hazraj, who had been in confrontation and war with each other for many years, became like one with each other due to the grace of the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. One of the chiefs of Hazraj was Abdullah bin Ubay, and the chief of Aus was Abu Amir. Abu Amir died a very humiliating death because he did not accept the invitation of the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. The crown of chieftaincy was being prepared for the chief of Hazraj when the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam arrived in Medina. So now there was jealousy and envy in his heart for the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. He seemingly became a Muslim, but spent his entire life in conspiracies and scheming against the Muslims, and was the leader of the hypocrites, the munafiqun. The helpers of Medina, the Ansar, fulfilled their duties as hosts. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "These are the people who helped you. They are the truthful ones, for whom Allah has forgiveness and a great reward." The Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam said, "He who loves me will love the Ansar." The believer cannot hate the Ansar, and the disbeliever cannot love the Ansar. The society was established according to the Islamic principles, and the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam laid the foundation of the Islamic empire after establishing Muwahad, brotherhood. This empire was based on the foundational principles that the whole world follows today. Yathrib, which became enlightened after the advent of the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, became Medina, the city of lights. It was enlightened by the light of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Now Muslims also had religious freedom. Now the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also began to make treaties with the various tribes of the Jews so that a society could be formed in which there would be no clash. On the other hand, the Muslims were also aggrieved that their lands, houses and possessions which they had left behind had been usurped by the infidels. The trade caravans used to pass through Medina. The Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam thought that the Muslims would be able to attack the caravans of the infidels passing by and loot their property, because the infidels had plundered the wealth of the Muslims. Abu Sufyan, one of the prominent chiefs of Mecca, he left Mecca for Syria with a large caravan. It was decided to take the wealth of this caravan. The Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam formed a detachment to stop the caravan. Abu Sufyan heard of this, and on his way to Syria, he saved his caravan. But on his return, he was deeply concerned that the Muslims would be lying in wait for him. They would attack the caravan full of extremely valuable equipment, loaded on more than 1,000 camels. He also dispatched some spies before his caravan was about to reach Medina to go and realize the Muslims' preparations. Contrarily, in pursuit of this caravan, 315 companions of the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam had come out of Medina. These were the companions of Badr. They had one horse and 80 camels. The Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam selected three companions per camel. The three companions would travel on it in turns. So they set out to chase the caravan so that when the caravan was within reach, they would stop it. When Abu Sufyan saw this, he sent a speedy messenger to Makkah, who climbed the mountain of Makkah, tore his clothes, and split his ears, and told the people of Makkah that their wealth had been looted. He cried, "The Muslims looted all your wealth." And there the rumor was circulated that the caravan had been looted, as every tribe had its capital invested. When they heard the news, they all rapidly began preparing to take revenge on the Muslims. All the chiefs of the Quraysh started preparing for a battle, and an army of 1,000 men loaded with equipment was gathered. This is a battle in which Satan himself personally took part, and Allah Almighty sent the angels of mercy from heaven under the leadership of Jibreel alayhi salam. This is a battle in which truth and falsehood were decided. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in the glorious Quran,
وَقُلْ جَاءَ الْحَقُّ وَزَهَقَ الْبَاطِلِ إِنَّ الْبَاطِلَ كَانَ زَهُوقًا.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and say, the truth has come and falsehood has fled. Surely falsehood has to perish. It was an unparalleled battle between truth and falsehood. There are 313 who lacked weapons and provisions and didn't even intend to go into battle. They had set out for the caravan. But when this news reached Makkah, the infidels prepared for battle and prepared 1,000 men. Some of the infidels said, "We are receiving news that our caravan has survived. We do not need a battle." So Abu Jahl opposed it, saying that this is the opportunity that has come to us in which we will put an end to this fitna, ma'azallah, this corruption. The disbelievers were also worried that if their chiefs and young men evacuated Makkah and left, then their enemies, Bani Kinana, would attack from behind and capture their land. Satan came in the form of Suraqah bin Malik and said, "I guarantee you that Banu Kinana will not attack." The Quran says, وَإِذْ زَيَّنَ لَهُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ أَعْمَالَهُمْ وَقَالَ لَا غَالِبَ لَكُمُ الْيَوْمَ مِنَ النَّاسِ وَإِنِّي جَارٌ لَكُمْ فَلَمَّا تَرَاءَتِ الْفِئَتَانِ نَقَصَ عَلَىٰ عَاقِبَيْهِ وَقَالَ إِنِّي بَرِيءٌ مِّنْكُمْ إِنِّي أَرَىٰ مَا لَا تَرَوْنَ إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهَ وَاللَّهُ شَدِيدُ الْعِقَابِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states, and recall when Satan made the actions of these disbelievers appear attractive to them, and he said to them, "None of the people can overpower you today, and I am certainly your protector and helper." But when both the armies stood face to face against each other, he turned on his heels and said, "I am indeed averse to you. Certainly, I see what you do not see. Surely, I fear Allah, and Allah is severe in punishment." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states,
وَمَا أَنزَلْنَا عَلَىٰ عَبْدِنَا يَوْمَ الْفُرْقَانِ يَوْمُ الْتَقَى الْجَمْعَانِ وَاللَّهُ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states, and in that revelation which we sent down on our exalted servant, on the day of decision, the day of discrimination between truth and falsehood, the day when the two armies of the believers and the disbelievers encountered in the battlefield of Badr. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has absolute power over everything. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in the glorious Quran, وَلَقَدْ نَصَرَكُمُ اللَّهُ بِبَدْرٍ وَأَنْتُمْ أَذِلَّةٌ فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states, and Allah helped you in the battle of Badr, whereas you had little resources at that time. Therefore, fear Allah so that you may become grateful. Now when this caravan left, the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam received the news that the disbelievers were coming in thousands. The Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam began to think about whether to go back or not. In such a situation, Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala delivered a sermon and raised the faith of the Muslims that it is time that we should not retreat. Our faith requires that we confront them if they are to come. Hazrat Muqtad bin Amr, who was an Ansari, stood up and delivered a sermon saying, O Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, you will not consider us as the disciples of Prophet Musa alayhi salam, the Prophet Moses, or as the children of Bani Israel, that we say that you and your God go and fight. We are sitting here. We are with you, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. When the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam saw the love and affection of his devotees, the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam said, we will fight and we will not return. We will fight the army of disbelievers today. The location of Badr was decided for the battle to be contested, which was at a distance of 80 miles from Medina. There a canopy was made for the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam entered into it, 313 believers, with a few swords, without special preparation, no resources, relying solely on the support of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the month of Ramadan, 19 months after the Hijrah, and it is a Friday night. The Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam stood the whole night in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hazrat Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu relates that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam was supplicating to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with such an expression of grief that the shroud of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam would fall to the ground repeatedly. We would return it to the shoulders of the Messenger of Allah. The Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam would humble himself before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and say, O Allah, I invoke you for your promise of victory. If you decide that we be defeated today, and if this little band of your believers perishes today, there will be none left in the land to worship you. O Allah, grant them victory. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states, إِنِّي مُمِدُّكُمْ بِأَلْفٍ مِّنَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ مُرْدِفِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states, I shall indeed aid you with 1,000 angels following one upon another. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down an army of 1,000 angels for success. When it rained, the sand hardened. Below it became muddy. It became difficult for the disbelievers, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it easy for the Muslims. For the Muslims, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down sakina, sent down tranquility, When they awoke, they were happy and energized. A handful of people, full of faith. And opposite them, an army of 1,000. When the battle began, the Muslims began to destroy them. Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu relates that whenever I went to the tent, to the Arish, I would find the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam in prostration, and I heard the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam recite, Ya Hayyu Ya Qayyum, Ya Hayyu Ya Qayyum. He kept repeating until we were victorious. We killed 70 people and took 70 prisoners. This was the victory that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to the religion, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised his glorious name. The Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam came to Medina with 70 prisoners. 17 Muslims sacrificed their lives in this battle. 17 were martyred. The companions of Badr, to whom the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam said, Allah has forgiven all your sins. They were the people who stood by when no one stood. All the chiefs of the infidels were killed, and Atba, Sheba, and Abu Jahl were entered into the hellfire. Dear listeners, in the next program, we will discuss further the prisoners who were brought back by the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, those 70 prisoners, and the generosity of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turned the hearts of the disbelievers, how Islam achieved exaltation. We hope you will stay with us. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Ya Nabi Salam Alayka, Ya Rasul Salam Alayka, Ya Habib Salam Alayka, Salawat.